Would you stand to your feet as we praise the Lord this morning? He is good, amen? He's so good.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad, 'cause I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful generations, so why would he fail now? He won't.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, Hallelujah. Oh, we're so undeserving. It's only through him that I stand here. Only through him that I have a voice to speak. It's only through his blood that's made me who I am and who I will be. Lord, we thank you for this day. Oh God, I know people have come here with so many burdens and cares. And the thing that I hear the Lord saying over and over this week is, cast your cares upon me because I care for you. You have to come to him. He says, come to me. Come to me. Praise him. This week, I don't know if anybody else has had a week or even this morning like I've had. It's just been a day already. But God is calling us to come to him. We can get through anything. What we're just praying, he's faithful. He never fails. We're singing these things. Do you mean them? Have you come to him this week? Have you cast your cares upon him? Because if he cares for you, he does little things to show you that all week long. Little things for me. He gave me rain. I needed rain. Oh God, I needed that refreshing rain, and he gave it to me yesterday, and I praise him for it. I needed the little things, the little tiny things to show him that he cares for me, because I'm coming to him. I come to him, he cares for me. And I'm telling you, praise him. Praise him before you get on the other side of whatever you're going through. Praise him now. Praise him now. Let's just lift up a voice of praise and hallelujah for who he's brought us, who he's made us, because it's only him. It is only him. He says, put on a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Put on your praise right now. Do press in more. Press in more from whatever you are. Wherever you are, press in more. Lay everything at his feet. I'm telling you, it's so worth it. He is so good. He is so good. If I'm standing here, he's good, okay? It's only him. It is only him. I just compel you guys, compel you to do something more today. Give an action to your praise. If it's to come forward because he's calling you to come to him and cast it, then do the action. Do a prophetic action of faith. Cast your cares upon him because he cares for you. Thank you.
this is what I'm hearing the Lord say. He said, and when you see these things beginning to happen, you know that the end is near. So lift up your heads, lift up your heart, lift up your hand. Your redemption's drawing near. The powers of heaven and earth will be shaken. Yes, they will. The powers will fall, but heaven and earth, but my kingdom will never pass away. And the gates of hell will not prevail against my church. And I say unto you that you are seeing things around you that are evil, but I say you don't see what I'm doing, says the Lord. I'm doing a greater work. I'm doing a work you don't even know anything about. And I say I'll have the last say. And I say unto you, look at my nation, Israel. Do not underestimate them, says the Lord. These are my people. I have an everlasting love for them. I will never forsake them. And I will not forsake you, says the Lord. And I love you everlastingly. And Israel is the apple of my eye. And you are the apple of my eye. Don't forget it, says the Lord. When you see all these things coming to pass, you just know that I'm here. And you know that the end is near. And I'm saying to you, many false prophets have gone out, and I see my people following them. But I say unto you, they're telling lies. And they're saying that God said, and I did not say, says the Lord. And I say unto you, be careful who you hear and who speaks into your life. Listen and make sure it applies, if my word applies, says the Lord. Prayer is the key, my people. You must pray. You must seek my face. And repentance is the other key. You must repent of anything in your life because great things are about to come about. Evil is going to prevail and it's going to get worse. But I say unto you, your light is going to get brighter. My light will shine brighter. I will do great and mighty things in this earth. I want you to know that today is the day of salvation. If you don't know me today, you need to come because the time is drawing near. And I say unto you, I want my people to come together. And I want them to pray. I want them to love one another. I want families to come together. Stop fighting. Stop feuding. But come to me, says the Lord. Cast all your care on me because I do care for you and I will take care of you, says the Lord.
I had something funny to say, but I'm going to follow the instructions. So let us pray. Father, thank you. Thank you that you're here amongst us. Thank you, God, that you're so kind to warn us and remind us. Thank you, God, that you're always ready to jumpstart our hearts so that if anybody came in here with their heart just feeling weak and low and uninterested, Father, your Holy Spirit will restore us and restart us so that we can continue pressing on in prayer and holy living, God. We praise you, God, because you are faithful. We praise you, God, because you are vigilant. We praise you, God, because you don't sleep or slumber. We can get tired, but you don't. And you are faithful, God. For any of us, God, that are walking in here just going through the motions because it's the routine that we've developed, Holy Spirit, speak life into those dry bones. Help us renew our strength and our joy for loving you, for serving you, for speaking your words and sharing the kingdom to everyone. Father, thank you, God, for our country. Thank you for Israel, Father. We pray for the peace of Israel right now, God. We come in agreement with our brothers and sisters over there, God. It's not the Iron Dome that protects them. It's your mighty hand that protects them, God. And we thank you, God, that you're ever faithful, God. No, those missile systems can fail, but you will never fail. And if you're not failing them, you're not failing us, God. And we love you, my Lord. We praise you, my King. Thank you for this wonderful day, God. Thank you, God, because maybe we came in here with the lousy attitude. We came in here tired, but Father, Holy Spirit, I pray right now, call us into remembrance everything that we need to be grateful for so that our attitudes can change, so they can see you in us, God, So they, when people look at us, when our friends look at us, when our family members look at us, they see your beautiful face. They see your smiling face. They hear your words. They feel your touch through our hands, Jesus. I praise you, Lord. And I thank you, God, for your word. In Jesus' name, amen. I just want to read this to you. Psalms 106, 1. It says, praise the Lord, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Who can list the glorious miracles of the Lord? Who can ever praise him enough? I don't know if we can praise him enough. 4 or 5 songs. That last song was amazing. Can you praise him enough? Can you tell him thank you enough? I mean, seriously. Can we thank him enough? I don't know how good he's been to you, but the fact that you're standing here shows me that he cares that your life existed today. Because it's not by chance that we live the days that we live. It's because of his doing. So if you got nothing else to be grateful for today, be grateful that you're standing here in his presence and loving him. I gotta welcome the visitors. I hope there's visitors here. If there's visitors here, would you please sit down, take a seat. We have ushers that wanna come and give you a connection card because we wanna connect with you. There shouldn't be any lonely people in this church. There shouldn't be any families that feel disconnected. And I declare to you that as you receive this card, you'll receive a connection. You'll receive an extension of God's love to you. Welcome one another and welcome to Spring First Church.
Y'all are like little ants that have traveled far, far away from your home. Thank you for returning back to your seat and for welcoming all of the people. We were talking about this time in our service. Somebody said on our staff, well, if we don't give them time to talk to each other in the middle of the service, like when are they supposed to do it? And I was like, at the beginning. or at the end. This is to welcome the new people. I'm just harassing y'all. That's my love language. If I stop harassing you, you should be worried. I'm glad that y'all love each other. We're going to continue in our worship to the Lord by bringing our tithe and our offering to him. If you need an offering envelope, raise your hand. We're going to make sure you get one. I want to read a couple scriptures to you. I want you to understand today that you are a beneficiary of heaven's wealth. Everybody, think about that. You are a beneficiary of heaven's wealth. The promise of Scripture is that if you will heartily serve the Lord and follow what he's written in his word, that he will pour out his blessing and favor upon you, and that affects every area of your life. And it makes people so nervous when we start talking about finances at church, but this should be a very exciting time in our service. And it's not because, not so much because we're taking something from you. We're not taking anything from you. This is the time that we bring an offering to the Lord so that we can engage his principles. The Lord's blessing, his riches, do not answer to prayer and fasting. I want you to marinate on that for a second. Because that's a bold statement. Well, Dave, we can pray about anything. Yes, you can pray about anything. But I'll tell you right now, praying and asking God to bless your finances when you have not followed his instruction, it's futile. It's futile. Because there are biblical principles that the Lord has put spiritual laws in place that govern how he works. And his hand is not committed till we play our part. Let's look at Matthew chapter 24, verse 14. Matthew 24, verse 14. We're going to look at a couple scriptures today. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all of the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come. Now let's look at Zechariah chapter 1, verse 17. The gospel is going to go out throughout the entire world, and then the end will come. Well, David, why do we give? It takes finances to fund the gospel going forward. There's people in nations that don't have, we were studying about this, that the Bible is translated into over 200 languages currently. But there's way more languages than that. There are people groups that have never heard the good news of Jesus Christ. And it's our responsibility to fund the kingdom of God so that the whole world can hear. Zechariah 1:17 again proclaims, saying, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, my cities shall again spread out through what?" What's the next word? They shall spread out through. Thank you, two of you. We're supposed to all read the next line on there. Prosperity. The Lord will again comfort Zion and will again choose Jerusalem. The Lord's looking to advance his kingdom. He's looking to pour out his blessing upon you when you seek the kingdom first. Let's look at Deuteronomy 8:18. I've had people leave the church because we talk and preach this scripture right here. You shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth, yes, that he may establish his covenant, which he swore to your fathers as it is this day. The Lord has a covenant with you that when you are engaging his promises, when you're engaging his instructions and being obedient to him, he's looking for people that he can establish a covenant with. Look at what happened in the Bible when Abraham starts giving to the Lord and sacrificing. He meets a guy named Melchizedek, who's a king of Salem. And he says, I'm going to bring to you a tithe of all. They conquer and defeat an army that's come up against them. And they've got all of these spoils. And Abraham gives him a tenth. He says, I'm going to give to you. And Melchizedek's like, hey, you don't have to do that. He's like, no. I'm going to take a tenth and sow it back. Sow seed, because Melchizedek was a priest. And Abraham could not hold back the favor of the Lord upon him. When the Lord gives him an instruction. He's like, okay, like you've given Melchizedek a tithe on my behalf and are sowing into the kingdom. He says, okay, but now give me your son. Abraham, it's one thing to say, hey, sacrifice your son. Great news to everybody. We're not asking for your firstborn child today at church. Okay. But the Lord asked Abraham to do that, and he didn't consult with Sarah. It's one thing to ask that, but to travel 3 days a journey to go do it in a certain place. We have a teaching in our school of ministry called deadly obedience. Are you willing to be deadly obedient to the Lord? I was talking to somebody this week, and they're, you know, you talk to people that don't go to church. They know this person, he's a good friend of mine, but he likes to harass me because I like to harass him too. And we're talking, and he's talking about church. Man, and he's trying to give me a hard time. Yeah, all that those churches want is your money. I'm like, yeah, that's not how it works, man. And I'm like trying to teach him biblical principles. And then I realize like he's not looking to be taught right now. He's just wanting to harass me. He's just talking about, yeah, all they want is money. They want to tell you how much your tithe should be. I was like, well, Jesus tells us how much the tithe should be. Like that tithe means 10th. No one's here telling you how much 10% of your income is. Jesus says that. Engage the promise. Let's read this scripture again. Deuteronomy 8:18. You shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he swore to your fathers as it is this day. I want the covenant of the Lord to be established in my household. I want that for you too. So I want our entire church to not look at this offering time as a time where, oh, well, I have to do this and I have to give this to support this church. Like, please wash that thought out of your head. We want you to come, and I want you to have an urgency in your spirit to say, Lord, I've got to get these funds out of my hand and sown into the kingdom because I want your favor. I want your favor. I want the established covenant of the Lord over my home. Because when we do that, do you know how much confidence there is in prayer when you go to the Lord and say, Lord, I have played my part. I'm telling you that there is nothing that builds faith more than obeying the word of God. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by that of the word. And when you obey the word, the level of faith in your heart, when you need to go to the Lord and say, Lord, I'll ask Amy, like we'll be praying for something, and I'll look at her and go, are we paid up? She's like, yeah, like we got paid this week. That's the first check I write. All right, I can pray different. That'll build faith in you. And the Lord will establish his covenant with you. Blessing, favor, advancement, you can't hold back. Blessing you can't contain. Amen? I hope you get that deep down in your heart. We talk about it a lot. We're not trying to take money from you. We're trying to get the favor of God to just be upon your household and upon our church. Let's pray. If you have an offering envelope, hold it in your hand. Tell the Lord, I'm so happy. Come joyfully today. Father, in Jesus' name, we come. We're happy about engaging the work of your kingdom on this earth. Lord, I thank you for this church that is a blessing to us. I pray, oh God, that you would take this offering, that you would receive it, and that you would advance the work of the kingdom across the earth here at Spring First. We pray for the missionaries that we support. We pray for Bible Alliance and the Fire Bible team that is actively looking to reach new people groups. We pray, oh God, that the word would spread about organizations that are having significant impact in the kingdom. We pray that you would make our church, build us up as a covenant house that you can trust to build the kingdom on this earth. We thank you for that. Thank you for the blessing upon the people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, Spring First family. Whether you're joining us in person or online, we are so glad that you're here with us today. We want to take this time to let you know about a few events coming up here at your church. First up, business meeting is next Sunday, April the 28th at 5 p.m. Dinner will be provided, and we ask that all Spring First Church members please attend. Next, our SF seniors are having their luncheon today following service. Join them for good food and community. Also, Kids Camp and Youth Camp registration and deposits are due. If you'd like to sponsor a student, please mark it accordingly on your envelope or online. Next, our young adults are having their community night, May the 4th, at the home of Given Fessler. And lastly, prayer and JBQ are tonight at 6 p.m. Join us as we pray for our families, our community, and our nation. That's all we have for you today. We love you and pray that you have a great week.
All right, we're going to play one more video for you. We've been pushing kids camp that's coming up in the summer, but we've also got youth camp for ages 12 to 18 coming up as well. And we want you to think about, pray about sponsoring one of our kids to be able to go. We have families that have like 47 children that would love to send all of them. We were talking in staff meeting and talking about the cost of this and the burden that it can sometimes be. And we don't want to put a burden on families that have lots of kids. So we're looking to help out. We were talking to Tanya. They're like, Tanya and Charlie are like the Brady Bunch. Like for real, like they're real life Brady Bunch. I think there's 14 kids or something like that. But hey, I'd love to help make sure that all of these people are going. I don't want anybody staying home because they couldn't afford to go to kids camp or to youth camp. So if this video doesn't apply to you, you don't have kids maybe, or you don't have grandchildren, somebody does. Somebody's wanting to go that would love to be supported. So think about that and check out this video.
They said, "I'm the apple of their eye," just like Jesus said.
Amen. Thank you in advance for sponsoring a child for youth camp. Amen. It's time to worship the Lord today through the Word of God. Open your Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 9. And I'm going to begin a reading in verse number 6. First Samuel chapter 9, verse number 6. And he said to them, look now, there is in this city a man of God, and he is an honorable man. All that he says surely comes to pass. So let us go there. Perhaps he can show us the way that we should go. Then Saul said to his servant, but look, if we go, what shall we bring this man? For the bread in our vessels is all gone, and there is no present to bring the man of God. What do we have? And the servant answered Saul again and said, look, I have here at hand 1/4 of a shekel of silver. I will give that to the man of God to tell us our way. Formerly in Israel, when a man went to inquire of God, he spoke thus, come, let us go to the seer. And he who is now called a prophet was formerly called a seer. Then Saul said to his servant, well said, come, let us go. So they went to the city where the man of God was. I want to talk today about the subject of as the altar, as the place of preparation, the altar of preparation. And preparation is a place where you're getting ready to do something. If in the definitions the definition of preparation is something done to get ready, and or it's the planning stage. Preparation is the planning stage. Say planning. How many of you are planning to be successful? Yeah. Amen. And we, you know, all through our lives, we're doing things that we're in preparation of planning. When Brenda and I finally decided to get married. And when I say finally decided, we dated for like 7 years. Of course, we started when we were 12, but. So when we decided to get married, she was 19, I was 20. And I was in college. She came to Dallas for one weekend, and we went down and if you're going to get married, you need to prepare a place to live. That's a good thought. If you're here today and you're planning to get married, you need to plan a place to live first. You know, we live in a day where preparation isn't a thing. But so I won't go into all of that except to say, you know, in the biblical times when a man was going to get married, when he got engaged, he left his wife, he left the engaged girlfriend, and he couldn't come back until he had built a house. And then there was a celebration, and he went for the bridegroom, which is typology of the rapture of the church. Jesus has gone. The book of John says Jesus has gone to prepare for us a place, and Jesus said it himself. He said, "I go to prepare for you a place, and if I go away, I'll come again and receive you to myself." And it's very typological of the fact that the bridegroom went away and then prepared a place, and then he came back. And so anyway, when we got married, we went down to Buckner Avenue in Dallas, in the southeast corner of Dallas, and we bought us a brand new mobile home. Single wide, yes. I'm not even sure they made double wide then. But anyway, we were preparing a place to get married, and we didn't get married in the mobile home. We were preparing a place to live after the marriage. So we prepared, and then 6 or 7 years later, we're wanting to have children, and we prepared a place for the babies to come. That's a beautiful story in itself. But I remember the time that Brenda was praying The doctors had told us we couldn't have children, and so we were trying to adopt a child, and she had an encounter with the Lord in prayer in Galveston, Texas, and she felt like that she was assured in her heart that the Lord would told her that it would be 9 months to get ready, and she started living. Can I just say it this way? She started living our lives in preparation for that moment. And I mean, her parents, great people of God, were trying to talk her out. You know, don't get your hopes up. You might get disappointed. And it was like, no. And I remember on Father's Day, about a month before Shalee was born, we were in Lubbock, Texas, and she showed me a newspaper, and she said, "Hey, baby beds are on sale. I want to go buy one." And I'm like, I don't know if you know this or not, but we flew out here. Yeah, that's when tickets on Southwest Airlines were like $19 a trip. And so we'd flown out, and I said, "I don't know if you know this," and she had her eyes set on this Jenny Lind baby bed. How many of you remember the Jenny Lind baby beds? Oh yeah. And Brenda was, she said, "Look, they're on sale." And I'm like, "I don't know if you know this or not, but we flew out here. We're 300 miles from home, and getting this baby bed back on the plane is probably not going to happen." And she said, "We can put it on layaway, and then we can drive back later and get it." And so I'm bargaining with her, and I said, "Look, I'll make a deal with you. I said, let's not go look at this one, even though it's on sale. Let's wait till tomorrow. And when I get off of work tomorrow, I will take you to Sears and we'll put one on layaway." Some of you don't even know what layaway is. And I won't. How many of you have never heard of layaway? Look at y'all. That's where you walk up to, I'll give you the short version. That's where you go to the store and you buy the item, but you only give them like, if it's $100, you give them like $10, and they'll hold it for you in the back of the store till you can pay for it 6 months from now. It's a wonderful plan. It beats credit all to pieces. Problem is today, I don't know of anywhere you could do a layaway plan, right? The only layaway plan I know about is at the funeral home. And it's not only a layaway plan, it's they have them where you can begin paying on them and pay for it later. It's a double layaway plan. So we get home, and the next day I go to happened to be staying at my brother's house at that point because he was building a swimming pool, and he was out of town, and we were overseeing that while he was gone, that project. And so he asked us to house sit while they were building his pool and check on it every night. So I went drove over from Arlington to Waxahachie to work, and that afternoon I had to keep my promise, and we were going to go to Sears, and that's the day that I went to the mailbox on the way home, way back over to Arlington, and that's the day that we found the letter from Pleasant Hills Children's Home that said that we had been qualified for an adoption, and barring any difficulties or complications, in 4 weeks we would have a child. So I'm like, Brenda's going to love this. And so I will go pick her up, and I'm keeping my promise. And on the way out of the driveway, I hand her the letter. And it's a good thing I handed it to her at that point, because we were about to get wrecked, because she went ecstatic in the car because God was fulfilling a promise that he had made to her. Come on. But the point is that what point I want to make is this, is that when you're praying for God to do something, you need to prepare for him to do it. And she was, so she had in her mind all the time that I've got to get baby clothes, I've got to get baby beds, and I've got to prepare a place. And so God wants us as Christians to always be in the preparation mode. When Pastor David was here just a moment ago encouraging you to be a giver, he's allowing you an opportunity to prepare a place for God to bless you. You're beginning to, when we give our tithe and offerings, he asks us to hold our offering envelopes and to pray God's blessing. Whether it was your tithe or your offering that you were giving today, a missionary pledge, that gift prepares the way through obedience to what God wants to do in your life. When you come to the altar to pray, you're preparing a place for God to bless you. You're preparing for this. When you commit your life to God, you're preparing an atmosphere where God can pour into you. In the old tabernacle, there were two altars. There was the brazen altar, and then there was the altar of incense. And the one place was where they killed the bulls, and then there's the place where the incense, it was just before the veil, just before the entrance point of where the priest would go in and represent the atonement of sins. And there is preparation for worship. Yesterday it was raining. Brenda was watching the rain and on the forecast and what was going to happen through the night. And Brenda made the statement. She said, I just pray that the rain will get out before people use the excuse not to come to church. Can I tell you what I told her? I said, people shouldn't be waiting till tomorrow to decide to go to church. Can I just tell you this? You know, I use this as an illustration with my parents, but we never were to ask our parents if we're going to church. It's an understood fact we're going to church. It didn't matter about the weather. It didn't rain. It didn't matter if it snowed, if it rained. I can tell you from experience, I found out that it was so important that it didn't matter if the road was washed out. We would figure a way to get around it. It was an understood fact, Martin, that we left at 9:15 to get to church. And we're not going with you or without you. You're going where you are going with us. Amen. Alive or dead, but you're going. And I made the statement to Brenda last night. I made a decision to go. Brenda and I guess I can say that I made the decision to go to church when I was a small child. When we got married, we decided that we would always go to church. And it was, can I tell you, it wasn't a Sunday to Sunday decision. It was a once and for all decision. That's good preaching right there. Because when you decide to go to church at one time, once and for all, then when, you know, I hear people say, will you be in church Sunday? Well, we'll see if nothing happens. Well, if you're looking for that, something's going to happen. So when you make a commitment to the Lord, and I'm not trying to preach on going to church every Sunday, even though I believe you should go to church every week. I'm just saying that you make your plans accordingly, and you make a plan that, hey, that's the Lord's day, and I'm going to honor it. Because, and here's the point that I want to make, is I go to church because I want to prepare my life every week for what God can do for me every week. And I want to honor what he told me on the Lord's day so that he will pour out his blessings onto me Monday through Friday, Monday through Saturday. That's good preaching. When we tithe, we're preparing the way for God's blessings. When we pray, we're putting our lives in position and getting it in alignment with the things that God wants us to line up, getting our sins under the blood, getting our getting the will of God and obedience in our hearts so that God can have a pathway and a stream to drive the blessings of God into heaven, into my life, into my home, into my work. Come on, preparation, being ready. My mom and dad, I happened to be 11 years old, right just before my 11th birthday. Johnny Barnes invented a program through the church called Royal Rangers. And with that in mind, let's pray that the powwow with Jason Bone and all the leaders and John Squires and all those and down in Hallettsville have a safe trip home today. Amen? Yeah. Amen. But I joined one of the first class of Royal Rangers that was ever started in my hometown, and I was like between 10 and 11 years of age, and in the Royal Rangers, that some of you have gone through that program, and some of you have your boys in there, and this also applies to girls' ministry, but you need to know, I've never been in girls' ministry. And so I don't know all of their codes. But I remember this, I remember what they called the Royal Ranger Code. And they had patches, you had khaki uniforms, and they had this patch with all the 8 points of the Ranger Code and the 4 codes of the doctrines of the church. And we had one of the first assignments that I ever remember doing in Royal Rangers was to learn the Royal Ranger Code. And the highlighted points of those was to be alert, to be clean, to be honest, to be courageous, to be loyal, to be courteous, to be obedient, and to be spiritual. And one of the points was the main goal was that a Royal Ranger always had to be ready to work, ready to play, and what's the last one? Ready to serve, ready to obey. And it was great points. It was great. Great things, but they were the main thing was be ready. And I'm here to tell us that God wants us to be ready. He wants us to be ready for the rapture of the church, but he also wants you to be ready for what he's going to do in your life this week. Yes. He wants you to be ready for what he's going to do for you financially. He wants you to be ready for what he wants to do to you and for you for spirituality, where he wants you to be ready for where he's going to lead you. He wants you to be ready for where he's going to be guiding you. He wants you to be ready for where he's directing you. And when we come to church this morning on a Sunday morning, we are preparing ourselves for a great week. We are preparing ourselves when we gave for great blessings. When we pray today, we're preparing a heart that's going to be receptive to receive. Preparation, ready. In the temple were the two altars, the brazen altar, the altar of incense, the outer altar for the burnt offering, and then the inner altar that where the incense was placed. And in the New Testament, the altar is an attitude. It's not an actual altar where we sacrifice the bulls and lambs. It's an attitude. It's a place, and it's an altar. We can call these stairways an altar, or we can call the wooden benches that used to be called the altars. Those are just pieces of furniture, but the altar is when we kneel before God, wherever it is, whether it's at your seat, at your chair, whether it's in your recliner at home, when you're bowing your head before the Lord, you are creating an altar where you are meeting God. And we need altars. Can you say that? Say it out loud. We need altars. Because the altar is a place of preparation. The altar can be anywhere you need it. I learned as a small child that one of my dad's probably favorite altars was the hood of his pickup truck. And he didn't make a big scene about it. He just, but you could always tell, though, when he was going to the altar. That hat would come off. He'd lay it on the hood of the truck. He'd bow his head. Can I just tell you this? This may shock you. I don't ever remember my dad saying a prayer. Personally, he was very quiet, meek, and he didn't do things outside. He did everything. But I can tell you this, I saw him pray many times. I had seen him at the altar. I've knelt beside him and prayed, and I knew he was praying, but he wasn't making a public show. He was making an altar for him and God. Preparing his heart, preparing. And the altar is a place that you're not only preparing your heart, an altar is a place where you're meeting God and asking him for the petitions that you need. How many of you have ever petitioned God? Sure, absolutely. Can I tell you this? If we're not careful, we can make the altar more about, petitioning instead of preparing our heart to receive. Noemi, what's the song you sing? Prepare the way. Huh? Prepare the way. Ba-ba-ba-da-ba-ba, prepare the way. Ba-da-ba-da-da-ba-ba, prepare the way. Can y'all sing that later? Is that too short of a notice? You got about 10 minutes. What more do you need? Can you do it? When we close the day in the altar, I want you to sing that song, Prepare the Way. Because God wants us to prepare the way. Prepare for success in what you're doing. Prepare, you know, I want to live my life in preparation to go to heaven. I want to live my life in preparation for God to bless me financially, bless me spiritually, to bless me physically, to bless me in every way, to prepare the way. It's the altar where we ask God for forgiveness. It's at the altar where we ask God to reconcile. The old timers will recognize, when we talk about reconcile, what do we think about? Checkbook. Who said that? Is that you, Kendall? When I think of reconciling, I think of reconciling my checkbook. You know, now everything's online and you can see it online and you can, you know, through Quicken or QuickBooks or whatever program you use to do that, you can go reconcile it. But when we first got married, they sent out actual bank statements and they sent you your checks. And when you wrote a check, you didn't get to see it on your phone tonight. Or next week either, or next month either. You had to write it down in this thing called a register, and then you had to put the amount that you had in the bank, and then you had to do your addition and subtract it and then put that in. And then at the end of the month, they would send you a statement with all your checks, and if you were smart, you would go through and check off all the checks that had cleared, and then it was your way of making sure that your register in your checkbook reconciled with the bank. Let me remember that. Yeah. I love that. When I got the bank statement, I loved it. I had my first bank account when I was like 11. So that was a big deal. I didn't write a lot of checks until I got married. But I love that because I just love the fact that my checkbook could balance. But don't judge me on this. But some of you probably can relate to this. But I'm a neat freak. So I didn't like scratch outs in my register. So if I was reconciling my checkbook and I realized that I'd written down maybe misunderstood and 5 for an 8 or a 3 for a 5 and something, and I had gotten off, I had to scratch it out and do those things or go to the bottom and reconcile and just get it reconciled. But it bugged me so bad in reconciling my checkbook that if I made a mistake and I had to do a scratch out or I had to do that, I hated to open my check register and see scratch outs. So I would stay up all night and rewrite my register. David says there's therapy for that. Okay, so let me just ask a question. I that's an OCD thing, I'm sure. But I wanted my register to be neat, and I wanted it to be exact. And if I didn't balance to the penny, I didn't just take the bank's word for it. I wanted to know where I had made the mistake. And I would stay up all night, I have stayed up all night looking for 5 cents. Can I just get anybody that would say, I did the same thing? There's Bob. Who? Bob still does it. Yeah, a lot of you. It's called reconciling. And here's the point I want to make. When we come to the altar, we're reconciling. We're not just taking our viewpoint, but we're letting God put a viewpoint on us, and we're aligning what God's statement says to what our statement is. That's why that sometimes we say, Lord, I know what the Bible says, but you don't know what they did to me. And the altar is a good place to reconcile those things. It's those type of situations that can cause you to be at the altar a long time. Being ready, being reconciled, being forgiven. Because the hinge of eternity swings on forgiveness. So here's what I want to tell you today. You need to love the altar. You need to love the place where you meet God. You need to love the place where you can communicate with Him, where you not only just ask Him for things, but He can speak to you and bring into an alignment what He wants to change in your life, in your thinking, in your heart. And as we come to the altar, it's a place to get ready for that blessings that God wants to bring and condition our hearts. For Moses, when he was on after a bad sin in his life, he was on the backside of a desert because of his sin and couldn't be around people because of his sin. But it was there that at a burning bush that God spoke to him. That burning bush became an altar for Moses. It became a place of preparation, not about just his heart, but about what God would do for the children of Israel down the road, about the Exodus, about delivering from Pharaoh and Egyptian bondage. It became an altar place. And so the burning bush became an altar of preparation. We were at ski trip. We weren't at ski trip this week. We were at the fishing trip this week. Good job, Kendall, putting that together. Give Kendall a wonderful hand for his work there. I was rooming with Everardo Gomez, a great guy. And we were talking about somehow or another this came up. I don't know if it's because I was thinking about preaching. I don't know if he brought it up. But we started talking about preparation. And I made the statement to Everardo. I said, on our farm, everything was about preparation. I've preached this before, that, and we've discussed this yesterday, but is that most everything we did was preparing the soil. We never, except for when we put seed in a planter, we never touched the plant. We just always, until from planting to harvest, all we did was to deal with the soil. And it's much like our heart. Everything that we do from salvation on is preparing, letting God prepare the soil for growth in our hearts until the great harvest. Preparation. If we were raising cattle, we had preparations of building fences. If once we had the cattle and the fences, we had every morning I had to walk the fence line to make sure the electric fence wasn't shorted out by a tumbleweed. And that was my job, to walk a mile before school and in preparation to make sure that the cow, I was preparing before I went to school to keep the cows in all day. Preparation. We prepare for company by cleaning our house. We prepare for a vacation by planning. We prepare for vacation by shopping. We prepare for you know, as a kid, one of the big deals for me as a kid was we only got clothes about three times a year. We got them at back to school, and then we got them at Christmas, and then we got them at Easter. And those, whatever you got, had to last you all year. So mom and dad would prepare. So we'd go to school and we'd get a couple pair of jeans, couple shirts, and a pair of PF Flyers or Buster Browns. And that was our school clothes. And those had to last us. My mother would buy mine too long so I could grow into them. And then she made me roll them up. How many remember rolling up the you know, a lot of people thought in the 50s that rolling up the jeans was a fad. It wasn't nothing more than mom preparing for your growth. He'll grow into them. You know, then so we'd get school clothes. And at Christmas, we got pajamas and underwear. Then at Easter, we got suit clothes. And I don't remember ever getting clothes any other time. It wasn't like now, well, let's go to the mall and get a new shirt. Let's go to the mall and get you this, get you that. It just wasn't that way. Did anybody grow up that way? Yeah. I don't know what that has to do with preparation, maybe that, but except to say, when our kids go back to school, we prepare for them to go. We buy them school, you know, my dad would buy schools. I love this. We lived on the farm, so we didn't get to run to 7-Eleven. We didn't have Walmart. And town was the town where you could shop was 18 miles away. So when we bought school supplies and they put them on sale, Dad would buy a case of notebook paper, and it was to last us all year. Preparing. So I just ask you today, what are you preparing for? Not only in the physical realm, but in the spiritual realm. What are you preparing for? Are you living your life in preparation for heaven? Are you giving in preparation for God's blessings? Are you coming to and making an altar of a place where you can connect with God so that you can have a pure life and he can have an open door for him to pour blessings in? Preparing. In your job, many of you are preparing this week to make money, and you're setting stage of what I'm going to do this week to make sales, to sell goods. I'm going to have blessings because I am preparing. I'm doing to-do list. I'm planning for success. I'm doing all the things. I'm staging my calendar so that I can be productive this week. I am preparing. My mother loved gardening. I can't say that some of you might buy, do they still sell packages of seeds for like turnips and corn? Do that? Well, we did 5-acre gardens, so we bought them at the feed store in big sacks. We didn't, but she had, but my mother loved flowers. And she had, so she had a drawer when they would put flower seeds on sale, she had these little packages of flowers. And back then it looked like little, do they still make the little packages of Kool-Aid like they did then? Where you tear them open and pour the powder out? You can tell I don't cook anymore. But anyway, the flower pack, what'd you say?
Anymore.
Yeah, maybe I never did. No need both of us doing it, baby. Not when it's as good as you can do it. Flattery will get you everywhere. But she had this little drawer in the kitchen where she kept, when she found flower seeds, they were like 10 cents a package. And she'd have them in there because she was preparing for the springtime when she could plant flowers. Those always intrigued me. I remember one time, couldn't have been more than 6 maybe, I snuck into that drawer and I'm like, I wonder what it would be like to plant these. And so I took a package of them and I went out by the back porch and I dug a small hole the best I could and I just poured all of them in. Well, about a week at the most after I planted them, I hadn't seen them come up, so it might have been just a few days. I had an invitation to go stay with my sister who lived 250 miles away. She was married and she's the oldest child. I was the baby of the family and there's like 14 years between us. But she invited me to come spend 2 or 3 weeks of the summer with her. So I got to go with her, and I don't know how long I was gone, 3 or 4 weeks maybe, 2 or 3 weeks. I don't know how long ago. I just know that when it came time for me to come home, I was going to ride home with their pastors as they went to camp meeting, and they were going to drop me off at the farm. And I remember coming up the back road, showing them where we lived, and we got to they pulled up, and the way our house was situated, you could pull up kind of behind the house. And I remember when I got out of the car at the back where the driveway was, I looked over at the porch, and there was these big, tall plants, and I think, here's what I thought as a 6-year-old. Oh my God, I'm in trouble. True story. So we get out of the car, they're unloading my luggage and they're greeting my parents, and I'm out in the small tool shed getting a shovel and a hoe because I got to cut down the evidence. And I cut it down because I didn't want Mom to know that I had ever planted them. I'm a terrible, yeah. And my mom's like, what happened to my plant? And you, how many of you know what I said? Say it again.
It wasn't me.
I didn't say that. What plant? There's never been a plant there. Well, you know, parents are a little smarter than 6-year-olds. Or maybe I should say parents are a whole lot smarter than 6-year-olds. My mother had already figured out that the seeds were gone. She had already figured out that I'd planted them. And her story is that she was sad when I cut them down because it was when she missed me, she realized that I had planted the flowers, and that was her way of loving me. But I cut them down, dummy. But I didn't know I wasn't going to get beaten and was going to get loved on. I didn't know it was that Mom loved them. I thought I was getting ready to get a spanking for messing with her flowers. If I could have just had an altar before I cut them down. Yeah. I wasn't even saved yet. So give me a break. That's 3 years prior to salvation. I was a heathen. Demonized. Devil driven. The devil made me plant those flowers. You bought, ladies, some of you went and bought groceries this week. Probably all of you did. Because you're preparing to take care of your family this week with great meals. You went to the store and bought lunch for your kids to take to school because you're preparing for them to love you when they get in their lunch bucket. Prepare the way. Preparing the way. Mary went to the marriage supper of the Lamb, and she said, whatever he tells you to do, just do it, because she was preparing the way for a miracle. Yeah. She was instructing those disciples, preparing them for the first miracle of Jesus Christ. Can I just tell you this today? The altar of obedience must obey, override human logic. If you've ever prayed for something that seemed impossible, that's overriding human logic and believing that God can do anything. Altars, when we come to this altar on Sunday night in prayer meeting, when we gather together, we as a group are trying to prepare as a group to get ready for the miracles that God's going to do in Spring First Church. We're preparing our hearts for revival. We're, as David said last week, when we come to prayer meeting, that we're fueling the engine of God's power over Spring First Church. When you come to the altar, you're fueling the engine over. Fathers, when you're coming to God, you're fueling the engine of spirituality over your family. Matt, are you back there? Yeah, the light was blinding you. Matt, I keep going to call it a ski trip. It's a fishing trip. I rode up there with Matt, and he was telling me, he lives over west of Tomball, and he was telling me about raising cows, and I'm like, yeah, that's my kind of guy. And on the way back yesterday, he met up with somebody and got some cows, and because he's raising them for beef. Because Matt, what you're doing is you're preparing for lunch next year. Raising his own cows, feeding them out, getting them ready, preparing for a freezer full of beef. Don't you love it? Preparation. Say it with me. Preparation. What are you preparing for today? Because see, the altar of God is the leveling place. It's the place where you make things level out and cause everything to come into alignment. Alignment. Bringing it into synchronization. Creating the place. You know, my dad would, and when preparing for the crop before he planted, he prepared the rows. And he wanted them to be straight, straight. I mean, it was a huge deal for him to get them straight. And because everything all year depended on that. And it had to be, he was a perfectionist. That's probably why I got it. But he wanted them just exactly right. And he wanted every weed out of the, if he saw a weed cropping up over that section of land, it's like, go get that weed. We cultivated to kill the weeds in advance. But if one got by us and he saw it creeping up, go get it. Go get it. Go kill that weed. Because he was preparing for a beautiful look, not only a beautiful crop, but for it to look good while we were getting there. I believe this with all of my heart, that the Holy Spirit's speaking to people this morning of things that you need to be preparing in your life. Preparation. Preparation. Preparing for, I tell you, I'm preparing my life for heaven's, you know, the signs of the time are everywhere. I love the fact that, Martin, you prayed for Israel today. We prayed last week, and we're praying again that the Lord would bless Israel because Jesus is coming. Are you prepared? Come up here, song girl. Come up here. I want you to stand with me. This is not dismissal. In case some of you are wondering what happened, I broke my hand. I'm going to live. Brenda didn't hit me, and I didn't hit her. I lifted an 80-pound piece of steel, and it rolled out of my hand. It didn't hit me. I didn't even know it was broke until about a minute later. I want us to sing this song, Prepare the Way. And I want to challenge you. If you're here today and you've got some things in your life that you need to prepare the way for, whether it's a job, home, if you're without Christ today, you need to prepare the way to know him. And that's by asking Jesus Christ in your heart. Every head's bowed and every eye's closed. I want to lead you to that. If you're here today and you came looking for answers, I'm here to tell you Jesus is your answer.
Yeah.
And just by you coming today, you prepared the way to know him. When we were worshiping today we were preparing the way for the word. Let's pray this prayer. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me of every unrighteous deed. By the blood of Jesus, would you cover my sin? I choose you today. I accept you as Savior and ask you to be the Lord of my life. May this walk forward be with you by my side. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, it's just that simple to get saved. But as we take the second step of altar today, if you need God to prepare a place for you, or prepare a way for you in any area, or you just want to create an atmosphere where the preparation is made, I want you to, as they sing this song, to prepare the way, just flood this altar, come in, lift your hands to God and say, Lord, I'm here for you to prepare the way in my life. Come on, Noemi, thank you for doing this on short notice. I'm praying for you. Go for it.
Judah, let the lion roar.
question this week is, the prayer this week is, Lord, what is it in me that isn't ready for you? Lord, show me something that I need to be preparing to make a way for your ways. Amen. Do you lift your hands to the Lord and just pray that prayer? Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we see from the opening of the word today that we must prepare the way for you. Lord, teach us to be prepared. Holy Spirit, show us what needs to change. What do we need to be that's different than who we are now? Show us your ways, oh God. I pray blessings upon the people. Lord, I thank you for a congregation of faithful people that seek you and that want to live after your heart. I pray blessings upon them. I pray that as they go, that the favor of the Lord would go with them and be upon them and their children and their children's children. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow you this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We love you. Thank you for being here with us today. We can't wait to see you again at prayer tonight, corporate prayer at 6 p.m. We'll see you then.